All right. Hello, everyone. Sarah Knapp here. I'm the founder of Mappy Hour. If you are watching on Facebook, we're at mappyhour.org, and we're all about connecting people who live in cities to the great outdoors. So glad to have you here with us tonight. Tonight, we are talking to Benjamin Alexander, which I'm really excited about. And before we get into that, I just wanted to shout out our sponsors, Sierra Nevada Brewing Co. and The North Face, for supporting us and letting us run with fun ideas and finding like awesome people all over the internet, especially during COVID times, to come join us and share their stories. So shout out to that. And also, we have tons of events coming up in March. So hopefully you guys can all continue joining. Next week, we have some female surfers from Michigan who surf year round coming to talk about how they do that and their love for winter surfing. So that should be a fun one as well. And a few rules before we get started. Our comment section is there for you to say hello, introduce yourselves, ask questions for Benji, whatever you would like that is kind and courteous. And we just want to make sure we're respecting each other. So with that, we will look at the questions at the end. So we're not ignoring you, but feel free to pop them in at any point while we're chatting. And then at the end, we'll make sure that Benji sees them. So I think those are all my announcements. And with that, I'm so excited to introduce Benjamin Alexander. Hello.
Howdy. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Where are you calling in from over there?
Car park in Salt Lake City. I had my third race of the season today and just kind of in the midst of all of the madness. So I found a spot with some good natural light, maybe too much, to do this. So super excited. Thank you for having me.
Of course. And thanks for making the time in what sounds like a crazy busy day. So let's dive in. Why are you racing, Benji? Tell us what's up.
So I am on this mission to be the first alpine ski racer to represent Jamaica at the Winter Olympics. So the next games are 2022. The interesting thing about my story is that I just started skiing at the age of 32, just started ski racing last year. I will be 38 this year and 38 when the Olympics roll around. So kind of crazy, especially coming off of the back of a, you know, successful career as an international DJ, probably the most unhealthy thing you can do for the last decade of my life.
Do you feel like this was not in the outline? I'm just curious. Do you feel like mountain towns have like some of that like same vibe that you get like as an international DJ?
No. No, I mean, I live in Jackson. It's a fantastic town. But there's no comparison between the life of like being in Jackson and skiing every day, which I absolutely love. There's no comparison with like being on a plane and being in a new city every third day and doing that year round and just being like, you know, overwhelmed by stimulus and all of the things that come with that.
Yeah. So, all right, Jackson Hole, how did you end up there of all places? Is that like a mecca for Olympic hopefuls? Why Jackson?
Jackson is definitely not a mecca for Olympic hopefuls, at least not in the discipline that I'm trying to pursue, which is giant slalom. I ended up in Jackson, and taking nothing away from Jackson, it's an absolutely fantastic town and has some of the best skiing in North America, hands down. But it has some of the best powder skiing, which is the, you know, the real feel good stuff when you're kind of going through knee deep or waist deep fluffy powder. And Jackson is just the mecca for that. I ended up there because the same guy who got me into skiing just 5 years ago has a house there. And when I was figuring out where in the world I should consider to train, Tom is his name, was just like, dude, go to Jackson. You know, he's been there for 15 years. Like, where else are you going to go? Like, I got you. Like, let's just go to my house. And he's been my gracious host for the last two winters.
That's amazing. So, all right. So you're in Jackson, you're training for the Olympics, and you did mention your age before. So I'm wondering if that is significant, maybe relative to other skiers, or is that more significant because of when you learned? Like, how does your age play into your story?
So I don't necessarily think it's so significant with regards to wear and tear on the body. I'm the fittest I've ever been. I'm super healthy somehow after 10 years of being a DJ. I definitely don't have the flexibility of a 21-year-old or the 22-year-olds that I will be racing against when we get to the Olympics. But the reason I mention it is because literally everyone that I raced against just today began skiing at the age of 2 or 3 and began ski racing at the age of 7 or 8. So I'm playing catch up with, a decade, 2 decades worth of experience and muscle memory. And as I said, just started racing last year. Just started serious race coaching at the end of 2020, and so I'm playing this hyper accelerated game of trying to catch up with these incredibly talented kids. It's quite humbling to be in your late 30s, almost 40, and looking up to like 17 and 18-year-olds because they're just so incredibly talented. So yeah, that's where I find myself right now.
And how did you go from learning about skiing 5 years ago to deciding that you were going to go on this journey and really commit? And like, if you want to share the mental part of just like how you deal with skiing with 17-year-olds who do have this advantage of having learned for years and years and years, probably gone to some like ski race academy and so on. And yeah, how did like how, mentally, how did you make that decision?
So to answer the kind of the question in the middle, I don't really have a problem with looking up to these 17-year-olds in terms of their skill and their aptitude. I think it's incredible to see what the human body and the human brain can do given that level of conditioning. And really, that is the highlight of my story. Is it possible to hyper accelerate what these guys have learned over 20 years? And can I do that in, 5 years or 2 years of just racing? So I find that super interesting. Maybe I'm humble enough to just be like, I respect them for what they're able to do, and I'm happy to take pointers from the teenagers that I'm around. How did it all come about? It's super interesting. I knew at some point I would retire from DJing. Similar to ski racing, it's a young person's game. Maybe I didn't get the memo on the ski racing side of things, but on the DJing side of things, I definitely got the memo. And I didn't see myself being in nightclubs till 6 in the morning and after parties till 4 in the afternoon and doing this across 30 countries each year into my 40s and beyond. And I think sometimes in life you have to kind of cut off a good thing while it's still good to get a jump on the next thing. And that's what I decided. I felt like I'd achieved most of the things that I wanted to do with the profession of being a DJ. Kind of like the Pareto's 80-20 rule, right? You can achieve like 80% of the stuff pretty quickly, and then to get the last 20% is like really, really challenging. So I'd played in most of the bucket list clubs and festivals that I wanted to get to, had been able to go to most of the countries on the planet that I wanted to get to with my music, and decided that that would be a good time to quit. So 2018 was my last gig. And I was looking for the next thing, and it just so happened that 2018 was also the last Winter Games, which I attended as a spectator, where I noticed that my father's nation only had 3 athletes. 2018 was also the year that I got the opportunity to ski in a big group of friends and understand the social element of skiing and the outdoors, at an event called Send It, which happens in Revelstoke, hosted by some friends of mine. 200 tech entrepreneurs like having an incredible ski trip and drinking and on one of the other best mountains in North America, Revelstoke. And then skied in Japan and skied in Patagonia, both on the Chilean and Argentinian side, and was hooked. And so the timing was just like, well, what will be the next crazy chapter in life? And still at this point, it was like, well, I've only skied 15 days when I decided to commit to
It's
going to
wild.
Revelstoke for a whole month of training. And in that month of training, I got to meet with a former national level skier, Gordon Gray, who gave me the impetus and the belief that this is something that I could achieve with enough work and enthusiasm and effort. And so, yeah, realistically, I was trying to see whether I could do the Olympic dream as a part-time thing based out of New York and skiing on the weekends, maybe 3 days a week. But COVID made a plan for me, or changed my plans, and I decided instead of swimming upstream and kind of keeping myself in a city and trying to do this thing as a part-time thing, why not just take a break and say that the world is as it is right now? Let's go full bore with the Olympic thing and the athlete thing, and I can go back to the working world after the world is more normal.
I mean, I have no idea what it takes to train for the Olympics, but part of our talk tonight is about backcountry skiing. And I know you've mentioned before that that has been a big part of your training. So I would love to hear, like, maybe, what you're doing now and also the role that backcountry skiing has played in this kind of larger training plan.
Yeah, so What I'm doing right now is I'm abusing the fact that we are blessed with the opportunity to sit on a chairlift and look at our phone or talk to a stranger for 6 minutes and all of a sudden find ourselves 2,000 feet higher than we were and
It's pretty
enjoy
great.
the, yeah, and enjoy the forces of gravity as they pull us back down to the bottom of that chairlift and rinse, wash, repeat, and do that over and over again. And I have that mentality because the ski season was plucked away from us in an instant. Last year, and I almost have like PTSD from that day when I showed up at the mountain expecting to ski the 23 inches of new powder that had fallen in the past 24 hours, and hearing over the radar over the radio that Jackson Hole is not opening today. So I have not done that much backcountry this year or this season, but did a hell of a lot last year. Last year I did almost 90 days in the backcountry. I keep tabs on everything that I do. I'm very maniacal about numbers. And in those 90 days, I managed to climb almost 300,000 vertical feet, which is basically Mount Everest's from summit to sea level 10 times over. So how that affects my Olympic training, the obvious is cardio. I was in the best cardio shape of my life in early August. When I'd had those 3 4 months of backcountry skiing, which is obviously great for any athlete. And then secondly, when you are skiing in very, very variable, varied terrains and different types of snow, it's incredible for your understanding of how to navigate the skis and how you need to be adjusting your weight balance. So it's a really, really good exercise for skiers to get out there and get away from the groomed pistes, get away from the controlled terrain that the ski patrol makes safe for us, and get an understanding of what real wild snow is like. So that was super helpful. And just also learning about how weather can affect the snow. When you're in the backcountry, it's not like you can just choose a different chairlift if one area is not feeling so good. You're putting hours of your life, sometimes 3 4 hours to climb something just for one run. And so you better be sure that you understand what the weather has done in the last 3 days, not just for safety, but also for your enjoyment. You need to know whether the sun has baked it yesterday and now it's going to be really terrible, whether the wind was coming in from a different direction. So instead of skiing this face, maybe you just go 30 degrees around the mountain and come down a different aspect that was maybe hidden from the wind and protected from the wind. What was the temperature doing overnight and yesterday? And how was the cloud? So you become maniacal about weather because if you don't do this, then you're pretty much guaranteed to have a suboptimal set of snow or kind of like face of snow to ski down.
And so you had never been backcountry skiing before the season closed last year?
No, I've been heli skiing, and during heli skiing, I'd done a little bit of snowshoeing. But realistically, no, I hadn't done any backcountry skiing before the mountain shut. And so we're very fortunate in Jackson. We have an awesome hill in right in the center of the town called Snow King, which is actually where I train. And both Snow King and Jackson Hole Mountain Resort have been awesome to me with passes and all of that stuff. But we were able to kind of get our feet underneath us and understand the equipment in this very, very controlled terrain where there was zero risk of avalanche or any other bad things that can happen out there. And so after spending a few days doing that, obviously you get bored and want to get into like the media stuff and the bigger stuff and the bigger faces. And I've just been fortunate that Jackson is one of those ski towns, like many, that has a lot of really expert professional people that were able to take me out by the hand and give me some basic advice and make sure that I didn't get myself into trouble and basically just be a partner. You really don't want to be doing this stuff out there alone.
No, really don't want to be doing it alone.
No.
So, did you train at all for the backcountry before you went and did bigger things, or you just gradually did harder and harder ascents?
Yeah, just gradually harder and harder and stuff. So I have some very, very basic understanding of how to use the, mandatory necessary equipment that is required to be in the backcountry, which is a beacon shovel probe. And I got that. I've had a couple of days of lessons, or small lessons while doing heli skiing. So everyone needs to know how to use this equipment, not just for your own safety, but for the safety of others around you. So I knew that. And then, yeah, as you said, we just started to get into slightly bigger and bigger and spicier terrain. And I think one of my favorite days was in the middle of August, sorry, middle of April. And it's one of my Instagram videos where I do this 2,000 foot face off of Mount Taylor, which was just like probably one of the most, it was the trophy line of the entire season for me, probably.
That's amazing. Yeah, and I think this is a good moment for me to do my like PSA for everyone. You really do need to take an avalanche class before you go out into the backcountry, learn how to use the beacon shovel probe. All of our videos are here to inspire you, excite you, provide some information, but not to be the only resource before you head out. And that includes for all our East Coast folks. I know it doesn't feel as dangerous, but we still get avalanches on the East Coast. So that's my little PSA for the middle. To jump back in, do you think you're going to continue backcountry skiing to train for the Olympics, or was that kind of the moment?
It was definitely generated by the circumstances. I absolutely adore being in the backcountry. There were many times where it was just me and my partner, and, you know, sorry to say, there were sometimes where it was just me. And you know that you're the only soul that's around for like 10, 20, 30 miles. And the freedom that you have by being able to look around, especially in a place like Jackson or here right now, I can look at the mountains around us here in Salt Lake. The ability to just pick any one of those mountains and spend an hour or two just, you know, researching it on Google Earth and figuring out how the approach is, and the freedom of just being able to go and do anything you see, as opposed to the necessity to, you know, have someone else have set the infrastructure up with chairlifts and da-da-da or a heli-skiing operation. That's so freeing and so liberating, and it's just a completely different side of the sport that everyone needs to experience once under the right conditions. But right now, being on this hyper-accelerated path to get to the Olympics, which are, you know, 12 months from now, and qualification is 11 short months from now, I need to be laser-focused and be on my race skis all the time. And I'll be honest, there are many days at Jackson where it's like 15 inches of powder overnight, and you can't train on race skis. But I actually don't mind, because it's just great to be skiing the powder skis.
Yeah.
So no, there won't be much backcountry in my next 11 months,
yeah.
But it's definitely a part of the sport that will probably be with me maybe even longer than skiing in resorts will be, because it's just like, it's so peaceful to take 2-3 hours to climb up something. And it's so, the joy of skiing something that you've worked for, earn your turns is the phrase, is magical. And it's not the same if you've just been sitting on a chairlift. Case in point, if you see someone else skiing something in the backcountry, you will stop and you will smile with them as they are enjoying it and take photos and blah, blah. If you're in a resort and you see someone come down something, you don't care. It's like, whatever, you're just someone else that sat on a chairlift. But there's this shared joy of the energy and the effort that is put into backcountry skiing that is just unlike skiing in bounds.
Yeah, I think it'll be really interesting because so many people are being introduced to the sport this year. And, you know, there is such a high cost to being a backcountry skier, just with all the gear and the training and all of that, to see what happens in the next like 5 years. And if this community and this very niche sport grows and, you know, really gets kind of like a more of a mass appeal, like resort skiing does.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I think it will. That brings with it its own inherent costs and problems. I think this has probably been the deadliest year for people getting caught in avalanches on record, I believe. And I don't necessarily think the snow conditions have been the worst that they've ever been, but I think it's the combination of really, really bad snow conditions and dangerous snow conditions, especially here in Utah, combined with a lot of new people coming out into the sport. So it's just a wake-up call and a reminder that there's a lot of joy to be had, but you need to know what you're doing out there, and you really need to make smart decisions.
Yeah, absolutely. So you said 11 months till qualifications. What does the next 12 months look like for you?
I intend to spend the next 11 months in as much race coaching as I possibly can be. That includes heading across to probably California or Oregon to keep skiing when the mountain closes in Jackson. We have quite an early end to our season, middle of April. And that includes getting down to the Southern Hemisphere, whether that's Chile or New Zealand, who will have to figure out which one of those is open to me, or finding a glacier in Europe to keep training. It will be 11 full months of ski coaching all the way through until the Olympics.
And you're still loving skiing?
Loving it. Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, today I was fortunate enough to run CB's run at Park City Mountain Resort, which is the exact same run that they hosted the giant slalom for the 2002 Winter Games here. So that felt really good to kind of experience what an Olympic level course would feel like. And every day, like, your mind is probably the same after having some chats with you, that when you're learning something and your brain is engaged and you feel you're feeling progress, that's such an exhilarating feeling, and it's such a great place to be in. And it could be with anything. I mean, I spent 30 hours a week studying the game of backgammon during COVID. So if I wasn't out in the backcountry, then I was at home on the backgammon board or watching grandmasters play backgammon. And it's just like, I love to learn and move forward with things. So yeah, I'm having that feeling and that reward, dopamine hit from my skiing still.
That's awesome. And so in a few of the like press segments that I watched about you, there are some comparisons to cool running. So I'm wondering, what is your relationship with that that movie and with that story? And do you feel connected to it?
Oh, absolutely. So born in 1983, that movie came out in 93. So as a 10-year-old, half British, half Jamaican kid, that movie was like the zeitgeist of cool for any young person. It's a Disney movie, right? And John Candy's last movie. But that was like the epicenter of cool for that moment. And one of the, you know, many times it felt super proud to be a Jamaican in England. And honestly, this wouldn't be a thing if it wasn't for that movie. So if Dudley Stokes, Chris Stokes, and the other two guys hadn't have competed in the 88 games and had Disney not picked it up and made that movie, this concept of me going to Olympics would never have been a thing. And partially it's because of that association and that kind of the connotation of anyone that's Jamaican that's involved in winter sports has to be connected to cool runnings, even if they're not in a bobsled. And that joke that just kept getting repeated over and over again to me was part of the reason why I said, well, maybe I will do this. Now, interestingly enough, I had met Malik Yoba, who's one of the actors from the movie, the guy with the bald head who plays the angry guy, Yul Brynner. And he knows about my plight and he's like fully supportive. So at some point when I get back to New York again, we'll record some fun content together. And I managed through COVID to make a connection with the pilot, the driver of the 1988 team, who after we connected and spent, you know, a couple of hours chatting with one another, he realized that I was deadly serious about this and wanted to become one of my mentors. So we speak every single week.
That's amazing.
So there's lots of overlap with cool runnings. There we go. I can move this now and get some more natural light.
Oh yeah. Yeah. FYI, everyone, as soon as the sun goes down, this call is over. that's amazing. I did not realize that. I thought it was just like externally people were making the comparison, and it sounds like you're actually very connected.
Totally. As I said to Dudley when we first spoke, I had to give him, you know, props for not only doing this outlandish thing of getting to the Olympics in 88, but also, you know, just being there for me and really helping me understand a lot of things when it comes to the sports psychology side of things, and trying to navigate, you know, Jamaican authorities and all of that fun stuff.
Yeah. So we, a few weeks ago, had this amazing speaker, Lamont Joseph White, join us. And I don't know if you're tapped into his work, but he's doing this amazing collection called Skiing in Color. And it's visual representations of Black skiers just in goggles on the mountain. He's done like some historic pieces. And he said during our chat that a big reason that he wanted to do that was because he's moved to Park City and felt a little bit uncomfortable not being a white person. And so I'm wondering if you have had a similar experience in Jackson, especially like after moving from like cities and places that perhaps are a little bit more diverse than Jackson Hole is. Though I haven't been, so I don't really know. But yeah, have you had a similar experience?
Before I answer that, put a pin in that point. You'll have to introduce me to the guy. I would love to do something while I'm here. So have I had that feeling? So here's the interesting thing. I graduated from university in 2006, and I immediately jumped on a plane 3 days after my last exam with no plan to Asia. And I've spent pretty much 10 years of my adult life in Asia. So being the non-white person that's about 15, 16 inches taller than everyone else, I've just kind of learned to deal with being the alien, the person that sticks out. And I kind of thrive in those situations. It doesn't bother me. So moving to Wyoming, which doesn't have that much diversity, especially not Black people. There's a big Latino population in Jackson, but not many Black people. I honestly don't really notice it. It doesn't make me uncomfortable. Being the odd one out has always been my kind of modus operandus is, you know, I'm 6 foot six, I'm 6 foot six, I'm Michael Jordan's height. Like, I can't fit in anywhere anyway, regardless as my of my skin color. So no, I'll be blunt and say that no, Jackson is a very cosmopolitan, very international place. It's, you know, just happens to be in Wyoming.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. And I guess like while we're talking about, you and all of the fun things that you're doing, is there a shout out for how people can follow you and see like what's going on in Benji's life? Like how's the skiing going? How's I don't know what else you're up to. It sounds like mostly skiing, but how can people tap into that?
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm part of that generation of people that really love Facebook, and now Facebook is mainly for my, like, you know, close friends and whatever.
Yeah.
So Instagram is the best way to get me, and it's super simple. It's just Benji with a J, Benji dot ski. That's my handle over there, or username, as we might say. And that's also my website. So if you just type in benji.ski, it'll just propagate with the most important links that are going on in my life, whether it's the NBC segment or my latest race results or whatever it is. And that's just really a good way to kind of stay in touch.
Cool. All right. So now we're gonna dive into questions. And I'll also share a comment from Ben on Facebook. Thanks for sharing. Very cool story. I'm born and raised in Calgary, and we all love that film here as well.
Totally,
Yeah.
absolutely.
All right. So we got two questions so far. If you have a question, you're watching, now is the time to drop it in the comments. Nick is asking, what surprised you most about ski racing that you didn't realize before getting started?
Huh, that's a good one. So, these guys literally race on ice, and I'm not joking. Like, it's literally ice. So much so that if it's been snowing a little bit, we will go down the course sideways and just kind of move all the fresh snow out of the way because we don't want that. What they will also do is take a hose and water down the course and let it freeze before we race on it. And when you get to, like, the real top level, they actually take this machine that has these, like, needles that will inject water
What?
6 inches below the surface, so it is literally rock solid. So anyone that thinks they have, like, a bit of an understanding of, like, you know, skiing a little bit of ice, or skiing in, like, icy conditions, when you are put onto one of these courses, it is a complete different game. And there's one of the most famous races that happens is Kitzbühel, sorry. And there's this really funny video on YouTube where you can find where they allow the general public to go on this race course, and literally it's like within the first 5 feet, everyone is just like, it's insane. Yeah, so I didn't even know that that was a thing. It's insanity. But what it does do is it allows a consistent surface for all of the races to race on. So the opposite to that is when things are too snow, sorry, too soft, when there's been new snow that hasn't consolidated. So my first race of the season, which just happened 10 days ago up at Big Sky, Montana, the conditions were very soft, and I'm running at the back of the pack because I'm playing catch up. So after 70 races have been down there before you, the size of the holes that appear on the course are literally like 8 inches, and it's just like, I'm gonna fall into one of these things and lose a ski boot or something. So
Yeah.
yeah, that's probably the thing that that kind of shocked me the most about what ski racing is about. Because prior to that moment, I thought I was a good skier because I could just point my skis straight down a
Yeah.
hill. No, it's a different world.
So follow-up question to that, do you feel fear when you're racing, and how do you manage that if you do?
Yeah, I definitely felt fear this morning. I don't know why I kind of psyched myself out on this run. It's so steep that literally you can see the first two gates and then it just disappears. And then I just kind of psyched myself out about it. And that's partially because I still don't fully understand how to work my equipment. So in these very steep situations, you need to be able to angulate the ski to really get it on edge to make it do the thing it's supposed to do. And I'm still learning that. So how do I deal with that? I mean, I don't know. This morning I just went out there and did a bunch of high speed laps as a warm up, and then I just got into my own head and said, "Okay, let's just do it." And I had a great run. But part of the reason why I am where I am right now is because the ski racer who I met at the start of 2019, Gordon Gray, was the first person who I'd reached out to as a professional to say, "Hey, what do you think my chances are of achieving this?" And he said two things. He said, "Firstly, Benji, your technique sucks. absolutely terrible. You said, but that's to be expected because you've told me you're now what, like 17, 18 days into your ski racing life and you've only had two lessons. He's like, of course that happens. You don't learn technique by osmosis. But he said, the one thing that I can't figure out is how the hell you're keeping up with me. I've been skiing for 35 plus years. I skied since I was two. I skied at a national level. You are absolutely fearless. And honestly, having the lack of fear is a much better quality than having the technique, because if you're afraid with the technique, you'll only go so far. But if you're fearless, we can teach you the technique. He was the guy that really helped me understand that this thing could be a reality. So that's where I am on fear.
That's really interesting. Cool. All right. And do you listen to music while you ski?
Absolutely not.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
So here's the thing. I sometimes listen to a podcast when I'm on a chairlift or something like that, or I'll listen to music on the chair, but I'll never have earphones in. So sometimes if I'm too lazy to stop the music, it's just playing from my phone in my pocket and I can't hear it when I go down. I actually think it's really dangerous to be skiing around other people when you can't hear what's happening. And secondly, if you're skiing out of bounds or you're skiing between trees, it's really dangerous. Not only can you hit a tree, but a lot of people don't know about tree wells. And tree wells are the cavities that form around the base of a tree when a lot of snow has fallen. Sometimes these things can be like 8 to 12 feet deep. Tree wells kill almost as many people, if not more people, than avalanches each year. And if I'm skiing with you and you have music in your ears, and I'm calling and hooping and hollering to be like, "Hey, where are you? Are you still okay?" And it's just dangerous. I don't recommend it. Each to their own, but it's not for me.
Right. Listen to music on your off days.
Yeah, or on the chairlift, or just not while you're doing something at like 40 miles an hour between trees, or 60 miles an hour when you can't hear who's around you. It doesn't. Yeah, it's not right. I mean, Formula One drivers don't listen to music. Put it that way.
Yeah, fair. All right, we got a few comments. We got Dion, proud Jamaican watching. All the best on your journey, Benji.
Thank you.
Christy, I love your zest for life. Thank you so much. She's gonna follow you on Instagram. Oh
Amazing.
yeah, everyone follow Benji. All right, question from Ben. What thought process did you go through deciding to take a big risk or go on a unique path slash adventure in life? Was there anything you would have done differently? It's a great question.
Well, the interesting thing is, this has happened in my life three times. So we'll rewind back to the first one. The first time it happened is after I'd visited Asia for the first time in 2005, and I saw something happen. Something was happening in Asia with regards to quality of life, weather, cost of living, people smiling compared to people being miserable in London. And I just set my intention that I did not want to work in Europe at that point. I graduated from one of the best universities in England, from electrical and electronic engineering, and most of my graduating class ended up working for Goldman's and Merrill and all of that boring stuff, and just kind of like, a happy bank account, not really a happy life. And I just decided that I would just go to Thailand. And I did that without any plan. So this was my first big leap in life. And so the thought process behind that, because everyone thought I was crazy, even though I ended up spending 10 years in Asia, the thought process behind that was, well, what is really the price? What is the price of failure? Well, I go out there, it doesn't work out, and I have to find some way to get back to England, and I'll try something else new. So failure really wasn't that much of a big thing in my mind. I could always just go back to England and try something else crazy. The second big leap in life was when I decided to quit my job in finance. And pursue one of my hobbies and turn that into a full-time career of being an international DJ, because I worked in technology and finance before taking the plunge into a creative pursuit. And same thing, it's like, look, your office job is always going to be there. And if you have the opportunity to make money and do something that you love professionally and really see if you can get somewhere with it, there may be difficult times. And there were many months when I was living in Hong Kong that my income from DJing was less than my rent, but I made it work. And eventually I got to where I needed to go with that. And as I said, had a great career and playing in over 30 countries. And then I guess the third big leap in life was stopping that income source of DJing and forcing myself to try something else. And same again, you can always undo that. And I could have always gone back to DJing. I still get requests to DJ and all of that stuff. And I like to think of this, I like to think of the book, The Art of War by Sun Tzu. And Sun Tzu says, If you are taking your soldiers to invade an island, the first thing you want to do is burn the boats. Because if they have that kind of safety net of being able to go backwards, and I know this is kind of contradictory to what I just said, but if you burn that, if you burn the boat behind them or the bridge behind them, they'll fight like this is their only way out. And so it's, you know, that's what I kind of did with the DJing. I made public announcements that I would no longer do it. I set it up in such a way that if I did go back, which I could, then it would look like I had egg on my face, and I like to be a man of my word. So,
There
yeah,
we
I
go.
hope that answers the question.
Yeah. Awesome. And doesn't look like we have any other questions. So I have one more for Benji, but if you are watching and you have a question, now is the time. All right. So you go to the Olympics in 2022. What's after that?
That's a great question. So I am pretty certain that a part of my commitment to my current sponsors and sponsors that I hope I'll get over the next few months will be some form of kind of public speaking to motivate other people from low-income backgrounds, to motivate other people from diverse backgrounds, ethnic minorities, to get into the sport. And I'm super excited for that part of it. It may involve 6 months of traveling around the world and skiing in places and hosting events and all of that fun stuff. And so I'm super excited for that moment. But honestly, the one thing that I was looking to do as my main gig while the Olympic pursuit was on the side was to get back into the tech sector, as I'm fascinated with the intersection of where technology meets fitness and health. So whether that's Fitbit, Garmin, Peloton, all of these like really interesting new companies with the constant glucose monitors, blah, blah, blah. I think that's where I'll go after I've kind of finished my commitments to my sponsors and any of the charities that I may be involved with. And I think on my resume, having been able to get myself from zero to Olympian in 6 years should go pretty well.
Yeah, that's a good story. I like that.
That's my
Yeah,
strategy.
I love it. Perfect. Okay. Well, no more questions. Thank you so much, Benji, for making time after your race to come hang out with us while you're sitting in a car. We appreciate
Yeah.
it.
And we still
Everyone
have
who's
good
watching,
light.
you still have light.
Yeah.
Yeah, we didn't run out. Things are getting kind of close, but we're good. And yeah, we're gonna sign off for tonight, but everyone go follow Benji on Instagram and join some other Mappy Hour events in March, and we'll see you then. So bye.